All right, today we're going to take a quick look at the new model. It's going to be my next build. This is the Sonicmodell Binary, and I'm shooting this on this camera that you're looking through right now is my GoPro Hero 4 Black. And I just have it set up here, obviously, next to my desk. And I will be also taking some still shots and overlaying them at key points in the video to show you some detail of the model. It's not necessarily an unboxing, because I'm kind of approached this one a little bit different. Rather than a traditional unboxing and build type review, I'm just going to show you what the model is, and then I'm going to build it, and then we're going to fly it. And just kind of just take a direct look at it, basically. I feel it's a little bit more realistic, a more organic approach to as if I'd bought the model with my own money. Because, by the way, I should point out, Sonicmodell did send me this free for a review, or to build and fly, I guess, is what we're going to do with it. But like I said, I feel this gives you a more realistic, honest view of what it's like to buy and build it yourself. So that's how we're going to treat this one. So let's just take a quick look at some specs. And if you're not familiar with this model, I will put a link to Banggood's page where it is for sale below the video, where you can look at some pictures and specs. We're going to look at the specs here, but basically it is a FPV airplane is designed specifically for FPV. There's a camera bay in the bottom if you want to go that route for mapping and things like that. Has some scale features as far as like little spots in the wings and tail for navigation lights. And there's some optional tricycle landing gear with a steerable nose wheel. Or it includes a plastic belly pan if you want to go that route. It's a twin motor model, by the way. There is a optional power pack available that includes some genuine Sunny Sky motors this time. And the servos and things like that. And they did send me all of those options, including the navigation lights, the mapping bay camera stuff, the mounts for that, the power pack, the servos, all the electronics. So that was very generous of them, and I would like to thank them. And you know, hopefully, if you appreciate the video, you like the content here, just know that they are the ones that made it possible. It's not going to skew my opinion of the airplane. If I find any problems, I will point it out. They generally they like the feedback. And if you're not familiar with Sonicmodell, they make the AR wing, which it's just out of view right over there. But I have the AR wing. They make the Sky Hunter that I've flown probably thousands of times on my channel. They make the Zod models. They're Zod and Sonicmodell are both kind of, I guess, same parent company, I guess, on them both. But they are two separate divisions. I don't fully understand the differences as far as their infrastructure. But anyway, so enough rambling on. I'm kind of trying to change up the format of this a little bit, is to keep my videos from being too long, because that's generally something I do. I tend to run on and make my videos longer than they need to be. And I've already done that with this one, so we're just going to get on with it and get straight to the point. So, some specs. Wingspan is 1,200 millimeters, 1.2 meters, or 47.24 inches, just under 48 inches. Well, 47 and a quarter. Length is 953 millimeters, or 37.52 inches. Material is high-quality EPO. And like I said, this is from Sonicmodell division, not the Zod division, so this is not their biodegradable EPP from their more recent releases. This is standard EPO. The recommended optimized power combo is two 2212 1100 kV motors, two 40 amp ESCs with a 5 volt 3 amp BEC, servos, 9 gram metal gear, you need 6 of those. Props are 3 bladed, 8 by 4.5 inch props. You need 2 of those, obviously. Recommended battery is 4S 3000 to 5400 milliamp hour LiPo. I do intend to use the 5200 4S. Now, these are Turnagies and these are Multistars. I've been using the Multistars for quite a while now. I run a pair of these in my Sky Hunter, or single ones in the Mini Talon and the Dart XL. And the Talon Rebel GT. Run a single one in those, two in the Sky Hunter. Multistars were recently discontinued, so I picked up some of these Turnagies, which I believe are same batteries being rebranded. my multi-stars. I used to have two of these. I recently damaged one in a crash, which is why I picked up some of the newer ones, so I'd have a matching pair for the Skyhunter. So I'll be running the Turnagies from now on in the Skyhunter when I fly a pair of batteries. But my original multi-stars were the 10C rated, the 10C discharge. And now the multi-stars had actually switched over to a 12C, which was slightly a thicker battery and a little bit heavier. And these rebranded the Turnagy batteries are the 12C rated. They're 12 to 24C peak, whatever. But they're the 12C multi-stars rebranded as a Turnagy. I'm 99.9% sure of that. But if I'm wrong, I apologize. But I'm willing to go on the record as saying that I believe these are rebranded 12C multi-stars. As you can see, they are slightly thicker, maybe 2 or 3 millimeters at the most. I'm going to say about 2 millimeters tops thicker, but otherwise they're the same. They weigh a few grams more, but they do have a little bit thicker wires. But these are 14 gauge. These are what, 10 or 12? Actually, they're not marked. Yeah, they were 12 gauge. But anyway. Again, don't want to ramble on too long, but these are the batteries that we'll be running. Likely going to stick to singles, one or the other. But it's not a review on batteries or a video on batteries, so let's get on with the airplane. Now, there is some more quick instructions here on installing everything, including optional accessories, and kind of give you a layout of the hatches and some... their social media pages and things like that, their website, and this kind of gives you a rundown of the optional accessories that are sold separately, Binary premium accessories sold separately. Like I said, you get some Y-leads, some little servo clips, some little secure clips to hold those together, some extensions, 6 servos, two ESCs, 2 motors, a Y-lead for your battery, 2 props, and that's the power combo. You get the dusk LED lighting system, that's the navigation or landing lights, which are controlled from your radio on using a spare PWM channel. That is included. We'll take a look at that. The modular landing gear, you get your main gears, an aluminum piece, which are 2 main wheels, and a little bracket and a servo for your steerable nose wheel. That's included. We will take a look at that at some point. The plastic belly protection. I'm not sure if this is an optional accessory or if it's included with the standard kit. But I did get that. I will likely use it. And we're going to use the landing gear at some point too, just to try it out. But I'll probably be using the plastic landing gear for the most part, because I do take off. I usually hand launch my airplanes and I land on a grass runway. So the plastic landing pans work really well. I have one on my Skyhunter and it's held up for years of abuse. So I'll probably go that route for this one. A servo pack, 2 9-gram servos. Now this, I believe, is optional for your flaps, maybe. Actually, your 6 servos should handle your flaps, because you have 1 elevator, 1 rudder, 2 ailerons, and the other 2 for your flaps. So I'm not sure what the 2 servos are for there. I don't know. Maybe we'll figure it out. And the 2 8x4.5, 3-bladed props, and your mapping camera bay. It says mapping camera is not included. I'm not sure. I have everything, all the parts. It's kind of some laser cut plywood parts that you assemble and glue together yourself. So we will be taking a look at that. And there's also some, looks like some rubber padding and things like that. I guess we'll figure that out later when we build that. And they show it with a Hero Session style that looks like a Runcam 3S, a Runcam 2, and I think that says Hero 5, Hero 5 through 7. It's pretty much that style. Cameras, I guess it works with all those, and that will be a down-facing camera lookout of below the belly of the airplane. A quick rundown of servos and control surfaces and which channels do what, and a diagram of checking your control surfaces, your directions, and how they should respond given if you're using mode 1 or mode 2 and your sticks on your transmitter, and flaps if you choose to use those, and a little caution. And like I said, I will overlay this. I'll give you some detailed shots of this. I'll overlay it. I'll probably have overlaid it already while I was explaining everything. So that's the only papers with the kit. Now you do have some with the accessories, but we're gonna set this aside and take a look at the other stuff in the box. Let's go ahead and look at the fuselage first and get that out of the way, the largest piece. So here's the fuselage. You see you have your FPV pod basically in the front. This is removable, your hatch. And it just has tab in the front, two magnets in the back. They're located in a little plywood plate there. There's a plywood plate here. It's cut out for, I assume, like a pan servo. Should fit there. The ones I've been using, the these JX servos that I mod for my small pan and tilts. I do have a couple of those in the mail now. And if they're not here in time, I will borrow one from another airplane. I'm going to use a small pan servo one here. Likely going to stick to strictly an FPV camera. I'm thinking the Eagle Pro 2 from Runcam, which is my favorite FPV camera just for raw dedicated FPV, not HD recording. I'm not sure if I'm going to mount an HD camera on the pod up front or not. Likely just going to stick to a pan and tilt dedicated FPV camera. If I fly an HD camera, it will be in the bay, in the mapping camera bay. But things may change. But that's my intentions at this point. So you see there is some magnets around the perimeter of this piece here. You may have noticed those. And that is for the included... let me pull it out of the bag here. That is for the included canopy. There is a clear canopy. Now you will have to trim the, there's some trim lines there. You have to trim the extra plastic. It's like, it's a molded, like sand style canopy. Mine's a little bit distorted from in the shipping, but it'll straighten right out. But it's pretty clear. I don't know if it's going to be clear enough to look through with a camera. Well, you're looking through it right now through a camera. It seems to be fine. As I move it around, it doesn't seem to distort the image very much. But I don't know if there's going to be room to house a camera underneath it, because the pan servo does sit pretty far forward. So I'm likely not going to try to mount a camera under it. But it is included if you want to use a stationary camera or something. I don't know if it's there. It's up to you. And there's a little bag of magnets I did see somewhere in the box, or actually in the bag here. Get this little set of magnets to glue onto the canopy so that it just snaps on with some magnets. So if you choose to use that. So let's sit that aside, and we'll sit the pod to the side for just a minute. We'll take a look inside the fuselage. Now you have a battery strap, a little Sonicmodell has their logo, their branding on it. It's a little grippy, the little rubberized strap, Velcro strap like that with a buckle, and a slot and a plywood battery tray. And that's very similar to the recent Zod model releases, the tray and with the markings to know where to align your battery, to keep your proper CG and the strap and everything. And you do have a little plywood plate here with two magnets to mate with the ones on the hatch so that it fits securely like so. And you may notice inside the fuselage there are some carbon rods. There's one on each side that runs right up to the front of the battery tray right there, and those will extend quite a ways back into the fuselage. We'll take a look. I'll remember to point out where the back of those, where they stop. You do have two air inlets, one on either side of the fuselage, and just up front here you can notice you have a kind of a cutout. That's where your steerable nose wheel is going to go, and you'll notice there's a cutout in the foam. There is a little filler piece included. I guess, yeah, we can just push that out from the top side, remove it. So that little foam piece is there. If you're not going to use the landing gear, you can just kind of take this or glue it, whatever, to cover up the hole. And you see you have some plywood, little plywood tabs in here, which is where you're going to fix the steerable nose wheel module. And actually, I guess this is, after you get everything mounted, you still replace this. And there's a little cutout here for your nose gear to stick out. So that's pretty nice, nice little fairing. Same thing with the main gear. You notice right back here, there's a little removable piece of foam. And the main gear is going to attach. There's a plywood plate glued in already with some little metal threaded inserts right into the bottom of the fuselage. Now this little foam piece here, this little filler piece, I'm not sure if you use this with the landing gear or if you remove this and attach the landing gear in its place. I'm not sure, we'll figure that out later. But if you're not going to use the landing gear, you can just kind of tape this in place or glue it just to keep the fuselage smooth there. Now, while we're looking at the bottom of the fuselage, we'll go ahead and take a look at this hatch. And this one, again, is attached with a tab on the front and two magnets in the back. There's a little plywood plate here with two magnets. You notice there's some extra holes here in the plate, and that is for your camera, the mapping camera mount pod will insert into this bay. Once you remove the hatch and insert that piece, it will attach to that plate. And like I said, that will give you a down-facing camera view as you fly the airplane around. But if you're not going to use it, it gives you access to all the tail section in the fuselage. There's a lot of empty space back here. If you're not going to put an HD camera back here, you can mount some of your FPV gear back here, possibly. I said I would mention the back of those little carbon spars, carbon rods. They stop just behind the cutout, kind of above the magnets right up here. So they run the length of the fuselage from here all the way up to the air vents. They cover all of the cutouts where your pod is going to fit. You have this cutout back here, and there's also another hatch right up here on the top, which we'll take a look at in just a bit. So the entire front section of the fuselage is enforced with those carbon rods. And for being a $99, I think it is, I think it was $99 initially in the price. Last I saw on Banggood, it's $129. So if you're going to buy it, you may want to hold out for that $99 pricing. I'm not sure if it's going to come back or not. But anyway, it's around between $100 and $130 thereabout. And I'm sure it's going to be available at some other sources later. So, and I would expect it to be in a similar price range. But that doesn't include any of the accessories. Like I said, it's basically the airframe. But for being a fairly priced kit, it's not the most expensive around by any means for a dedicated FPV, well, a purpose-built, rather, FPV twin-engine model. The fuselage being pre-joined, the halves, I really like that. That's my less favorite, less enjoyable part of building a model, is joining the two fuselage halves, because you have to work with a large glue area, large surface, all at once, and get everything, all your plywood plates and trays and everything have to be in place when you join the halves, and all that has to get glued together at the same time, and then you have to keep everything aligned and square, and it's not the most enjoyable aspect of building a model, in my opinion, a foam model anyway. So they did a really good job on this one. The foam is really cleanly molded and everything is joined perfectly. You know, it's flawless. I can't find a flaw in that whatsoever. I couldn't have done a better job myself. So that's pretty nice as far as the quality of the model itself and the assembly that has been done. So getting on with the fuselage, like I said, you have this one large tray runs all the way from your or plate rather, the plywood plate runs all the way from the front of your battery bay all the way back to the little metal inserts, which you may be able to make those out in there. If not, you should be able to when I show the overlay pictures. There's two little metal inserts for the main gear. It runs all the way back just behind that, and if I'm not mistaken, no, maybe I am, I thought there was another little carbon doubler, little carbon rod down there. I think it's just a little piece of laser cut plywood that I'm seeing, but you may notice there's a lot of room. I can stick my whole arm in here just about. Now, there's not quite as much room as the full-size Skyhunter, but there's definitely there's more room than the Mini Talon and the Dart XL and the Talon GT. The fuselage is a little bit fatter and taller. There's a lot of volume in here, room to fit all your FPV gear and batteries, whatever you intend to fly in it. And it's accessible too. It's, like I said, you can get into the front quite easy. There's a bay to get into the back, the rear section of the fuselage, and then there's also this little hatch in the top, which once again fits with a foam tab in the front, two magnets in the back. And there's a little cutout there for your spar, trying to keep it in frame. But this is very similar to the Talon series. The Mini Talon and the Talon GT Rebel and the Nano Talon all have this little center hatch right up in the top. That's what that reminds me of, especially with the cutout for the spar. But you can remove that hatch, and you see you have your little place there for some standoffs for a flight control board style flight controller. I'm not going to be using that in here. I'm actually going to be putting an Eagle Tree Vector. I just bought one from a member on RC Groups who gave me a good deal on one still sealed in a box that he had never used. So thank you to that for that if you're watching. But you see you have these plywood plates which run far down into the fuselage, and it's tied into your flight controller mount also. And your wing spars and the mounting screws are going to run through that to tie everything in to, you know, take the load of the fuselage hanging off the wing, basically. So it's nice and rigid. Even with all the hatches removed and everything, there's absolutely zero flex. It's solid as a rock, but it's not really overbuilt to the point that it's heavy. It's just a real well thought out design, I would say. So we'll go ahead and reattach that one. Now, the last piece worth mentioning right here before we get on to the tail is you have this little flat shelf molded into the fuselage behind the wing with a little access hole. Now, I can see either a video transmitter sitting right up here or possibly a GPS receiver. I haven't really thought out my layout yet, how I'm going to lay out my FPV gear, but more than likely one or the other is going to end up here, either my video transmitter or my GPS receiver. Right now, I'm kind of leaning towards putting my UHF receiver antenna in the tail and my video transmitter on the front, on the nose, near the camera. And if I go that route, then my GPS will find its way here. But I may change that as we get on to actually installing some gear into the fuselage. So moving back to the tail, you can see you have a little cutout where your elevator is going to slot into. And there is a little kind of little channel valley molded into the foam right in there. Hopefully you'll be able to see that. That keeps your elevator aligned when you insert it. And then your vertical stabilizer is going to slot down into this cutout, into the top of the tail, top of the fuselage. And it's going to keep everything aligned there. And it also keys down into the horizontal stabilizer. And when everything goes together, you see you have two little cutouts here for your servos, which are for your tail surfaces. So they're going to mount all the way into the back. And there's some little cutouts in the front of the servo bays here, which to get your servo cables down into fuselage. And you might notice there's some little kind of recesses molded in here. There's some little molded covers, some little fairings which are going to fit over it. So the linkages and everything are hidden in the fuselage here, which makes it look a little bit nicer and more aerodynamic for less drag, more efficiency. So again, in keeping with the well thought out design, I like that. So that's your fuselage, and we're going to sit that aside and take a look at some more components. First, while we're on the topic of the tail, let's look at the tail surfaces. This is your vertical stabilizer, and like I said, you have this notch here in the back. You see it's going to key down into the fuselage. This little notch here is going to fit into this recess in the horizontal stabilizer, like so. And just these two pieces here, you can see how well they align and fit. Everything is really quality molded. And like I said, here is this little piece here, which is going to slide into that little ridge, that little cutout, little channel in the tail of the fuselage to keep everything aligned and locked in. So, I mean, it's not possible to put it together wrong. I wouldn't think. You'd have to try hard to say that, at least. It is just molded EPP foam hinges, and the foam is rather thin there. Not sure how well you can see it on this camera here, but I will do some overlays like I mentioned. The horns come pre-attached. There is a nice carbon rod right in here, and the horn does attach. It screws together and kind of clamps around that, encases it, so it makes everything nice and rigid. There is a second spar in the horizontal stabilizer. You can see it running the lengthways right across here. So this is really rigid. Maybe overdone a little bit, but there's no point in making it weak, so I'd rather it be too strong than too weak. Because it is a rather thin surface, and again, that is for efficiency. And being such a thin foam, it's probably going to benefit from having the two spars in it, so that's kind of nice to see. And as far as the vertical fin, I don't think there's any spars or anything like that in it. If there are, I can't see them. But once again, you have the molded foam hinge. The control horn is pre-attached with a doubler on the back. And See, you have this kind of little balancing piece here. So, and it's kind of dragging. So I'll need to trim a little bit of foam out of there, but it's not a big deal. I wanted to point out this little notch you see here. There is a little clear molded lens, which is included, which we'll take a look at in a bit. And this is for the navigation lights. So the light that goes on the tail, there's a little LED light, which will plug into here. And you see there's a little molded line down here and one down this side. I guess you'll probably want to run the wires down one or the other of those channels. Actually, I don't think it's pre-cut very deep. So I guess you may have to cut that little ridge. I guess they're not going to pre-cut it, and for the people that don't want to use the lights, but we'll probably run the wire down there and into the fuselage. But so it's nice to see that it's already set up for the nav lights. And if you're not going to use them, it's still going to be a nice little touch. A little bit more work, but I think it'll make it look better. So that is the tail surfaces. So now we're going to take a look at the wings. And once again, on the topic of the nav lights, you see there's a little cutout here. This one is for your landing light. And we're going to remove this little cowling. We'll take a look at it in just a bit. And on the wingtip here, you see there's another little notch here. On the corner of your wing is notched out. And that's for your wingtip lights, your navigation lights. So as far as the wing itself, it is a standard flat bottom Clark Y style airfoil. Again, you have a little plywood doubler at the root there. Your spar is going to slip into here, your main spar rather, because there are some more spars in here, which we'll take a look at in just a bit. You have a threaded insert, which is, there are some thumb screws included. So once you plug those into the fuselage, you will attach those little thumb screws to keep it in securely in place. Now this is the optional flap. You see it's molded in, the foam hinge is there. The control horn is pre-installed. There's a little carbon spar in it. But if you want to use the flaps, you'll have to trim a little bit of foam here, or maybe you cut them back to here, I'm not sure. Well, yeah, you can see the line right up here is pre-molded. I guess you'll have to cut this out and then trim some foam up here to make it flexible. So everything's molded and in place and ready to go. But if you choose not to use the flaps, then you can just leave them back right in place. Everything's rigid and not finished. You know, they're not going to be free like the ailerons would be. So as far as the ailerons, again, same thing. You have the carbon rod pre-glued into the aileron, the foam molded EPP hinges. Control horns are in place. So you just basically need to install your servo into the pre-cut bay here. You have a little fairing to protect your linkages from when you're landing any debris or anything like that. It's going to keep your control horn from getting caught on anything, linkages. And there's a pre-cut channel back into the motor bay, or the ESC bay rather, which we'll take a look at in just a bit. So you'll mount your servo, run your wiring back to the fuselage as expected. Now, your motor, there's a place here for your plywood firewall, which is included in the box, but it's not in the, it's not pre-installed. You have to glue those in. And these little plywood tabs here are for mounting your cowling, which will cover the bottom of everything, your motor, the nacelles, or the proper term rather. And you see you have little plywood tabs here where you'll insert your screws, which will thread into these plywood plates and keep everything nicely covered and finished. Now, as far as the airflow, you have an air scoop into here and an exit out the back. But your ESC is going to mount into this little bay here, and they give you some little plastic covers here, which I'm not sure if that's going to be adequate cooling, but I guess we'll find out. And if not, this would be a prime opportunity to 3D print some very simple little cooling ducts, some little covers which would glue right in place here and cool your ACs. We may do that, and if I do, I'll make a video on it and post them on Thingiverse to download. But the neat thing is this little channel here where your air exits also doubles as a place for your servo linkage to run. You can see there's a little servo bay kind of molded right in into the front here behind your motor. So if you choose to use your flaps, then you'll the flap servo will mount right down here into the motor nacelle, and your linkage will run right back out here and be all but hidden. So that's pretty neat. It's a nice little thought out design. So again, if you're going to use the flaps, everything's there ready to go. And if you choose not to use the flaps, then everything's basically hidden and nothing really gets in the way. So it's nice that they kept it optional, and it's going to work out great either way, whether you use them or not. So as far as the nav lights, like I said, there is some little molded clear lenses covers for the lights, which we'll take a look at in a bit. But the wiring, the channels are already there. Like I said, this is your channel for your servo wiring right here. Your wingtip light has a channel already marked that run back here into the same channel here, as well as your landing lights are already pre-cut and everything ready to go. I think that's pretty much everything as far as the wing itself, until we look at the accessories for it anyway, like the little plastic covers here, the covers there, the firewall and stuff like that. So let's get on with the rest of what's in the box and the accessories. All right, so first off, this bag, and you can see I actually haven't opened it yet. I have kind of peeked in to see what was in the bags, but I haven't opened them yet, so we're going to do that together here. Looks like this is all of your servo linkages. One of them is already sticking out of the bags. We'll go ahead and pull it out. You can see these are the little plastic clevises that just kind of snap together, and they're threaded there to just the length of your linkages with a Z-bend on the opposite end. They're not the absolute highest quality thing on the market, but they are adequate. And early on, I used to change stuff like this. I would change them out for a little bit more durable, like ball links or some thread lock, a little screw lock connectors, things like that. But lately I got lazy and I've been using the stock linkages, stock hardware with kits like this, and I've never had a problem with it. So I will be using these. You have a little assortment of bags here. These are some self-tapping wood screws, and these are the M3 threaded thumb screws for attaching the wings at the wing roots. These are some little nylon standoffs, which I'm guessing are going to be to mount the flight controller board if you choose to go that route. These are some more small little self-tapping threaded screws. I'm not sure what those are for. I guess we'll find out when we build it. Here are your two plywood firewalls. There's two in the bag there. Can't really see, they're kind of doubled up, but there's two of them in the bag. These will insert into the motor and cells to mount your motors. It looks like you're not going to use the X mounts with these. I guess the motors are going to mount directly to the plywood firewalls and then slide into place. Maybe you don't glue them in, maybe you just kind of slot them in. I'll probably be gluing them though, just for safety. But don't quote me on that. Like I said, I haven't even really looked through the paper yet. Here's some included Velcro. Obviously, it's sticky backed. And a few servo leads. I see we have an extension here, an extension here, and three Y harnesses. And once again, I'm not 100% sure if these are included with the kit. I would think so, because they're bagged with the standard hardware for for building the model, but do double check if you're planning on buying just the kit and not all the accessories, and you're going to need the servo cables, you don't have spares on hand, just double check in case you need those. Let's see what else. Dropping things down here. We'll take a look at this bag. These are some of the molded plastic parts. So we get two pieces here in this bag. This is all of the clear lenses that I mentioned for the navigation lights. This is the one for the tip of the vertical stabilizer fin. This is the two landing light covers. And this is the two wingtip covers that are molded together in one piece. There are some cut lines. You'll need to trim these. I would highly recommend picking up some Lexan cutting scissors or trimming scissors, which are made for trimming like RC car and truck bodies. If you don't have a pair on hand, I highly recommend them picking those up, because they make jobs like this much easier. I do have a set that I've from my earlier years, several years ago, I was heavily into RC scale trucks and rock crawlers, and I have a set that have served me well for many years. So I will be using those to trim these out, as well as this little part. This one is looks like a polystyrene or something, I'm guessing. Anyway, it's a little thin white piece. This is your fairings for your tail surfaces. There's two of them marked out here. You'll cut those out and glue those on after you mount your servos, or tape them if you want. Here's another bag. We're not going to open this one. This is your two little white panels that I mentioned. We'll cover your ESCs and the wings once you have those mounted, as well as some little metallic Sonicmodell FPV branded decals. But these are some 3M sticky backed covers for your ESCs and the wings. Like I said, I may use these, or I may 3D print some other covers with air intakes just to cool the ESCs, just because I can. We'll look at that. We'll figure it out. And I think that's it for, well, no, actually, can't forget the carbon spar, basic carbon spar, which will be used when joining your wings. It's a rather long spar, by the way, and strong as usual. And you also get a couple of sheets of decals. You'll see all of these, the trim and markings on the product images on the product page. So they do include two sheets of decals to make your model look like the product images, basically. I'm not sure if I'll use them or not. I do kind of like the scheme. I'm not sure about the sea rescue thing because I don't live anywhere near the sea, but I may use the rest of them. I'm not sure. Or I may do something else with some trim tape. That is yet to be determined. And again, this is the plywood belly pan, and there is a little cutout. So if you're going to use, if you want to put the plywood pan on it and also use the landing gear just some of the time, not all the time, you can trim out that spot there and I guess tape it back on when you land with the belly pan, so it doesn't scoop up grass and things with the front of this cutout. Or if you're never going to mount the landing gear, you can just glue the pan on and leave it solid. But again, you will need to trim it around the trim lines before gluing it on. You'll have to glue this on the fuselage yourself. So now we can take a look at the optional accessories, which I have them all here. So first we'll take a look at the power pack. So everything, you get a lot in here basically. You do get some genuine Sunny Sky motors. They're not clones or anything like that. If they are, they did a very good job. They even used a logo this time. But I do believe they're genuine Sunny Sky motors. They are the recommended 2212 1100 kV. And they come pre-wired with bullet connectors and your prop adapters fitted and nylock nuts and everything, as you would expect. These do look like genuine Sunny Sky motors to me, as far as I can tell from the outside. I'm looking inside at the windings and the magnets, and as far as I can tell, I think they're genuine. And if not, they're a blatant clone, including the branding and everything. So I doubt they did that. You do get two of those. Yeah, there's another one in the bag here, which I haven't opened yet. This is some more servo cables and battery leads. Let's take a look at what everything that's in here. There's a lot of stuff in here, actually, a lot of wires, cables. Okay, once again, we have servo extensions. There's 2, 3, 4 extensions. Another shorter extension. Another shorter extension. And 3 Y leads. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of these little clips, which basically are used for securing servo connectors like that, so that they can't become disconnected in flight. So you get all of those cables and little connectors, as well as an XT60 lead, a Y lead for running one battery to power both ESCs. or in my case, I'm going to run everything through a current sensor for my OSD. Speaking of ESCs, you have two of those. They are Sonicmodell branded 40 amp brushless ESCs with a 5 volt 3 amp BEC included. And I'm assuming these are going to be the same as the ones included in the recent Zod models that I reviewed. And if they are, they are switching BECs. Normally, I like to use a separate external BEC for safety. But the fact that we do have two of them on this model, I may end up using both of them. And in case one fails, you have a backup. Because like I said, I'm using the Eagle Tree Vector, and you do have two inputs for your 5-volt supply to power your servos and radio. So I may wire these up, one primary and one secondary 5-volt supplies, and just use them. Now you have these little BEC connectors, little JST BEC style connectors, and these feed your main battery voltage. So whatever your battery plugs in is also available on these little connectors here for powering accessories and things, which is handy, nice to have. And you can see just how long the battery leads are on here, and that's so that they can run out of the wing all the way back down into the fuselage. And like I said, I may end up having to shorten these a little bit because I'm going to be using a current sensor in the fuselage. So I'll take a look at that after I get everything installed. I'll do another quick look, and you can see how I ended up doing things. And here's another one just like it, the second one. You do have the two included props. These are three-bladed 8x4.5, which is the recommended props. And they do include the little prop reducers to fit the motor shafts. These are not branded. Actually, they are FC. Not sure who makes it, but they're standard plastic props. And they are counter-rotating. Yes, they are. So you do have one. Yeah, this is 8x4.5 right, 8x4.5 left. So you do have two counter-rotating props, which is nice because it is a twin, so you can set those up to spin opposite directions. Well, you have to if you use these props to spin opposite directions and counter any torque thrust. So that's one of the benefits of a twin engine model. So it's nice to see that they did go with counter-rotating props. We'll just sit those over here for now. These are M3 machine screws. They're pan head Allen screws and washers. I'm pretty sure these are going to be for mounting the motors to the firewalls. And you do have six servos. These are not branded. They're just generic black servos. Metal gear. That's all I can tell you now. I don't know if they're analog or digital. If they are the same as the ones included in the Zod models that I've reviewed recently, being the Talon GT Rebel and the Dart XL, I'm going to go out on a limb and say they probably are. And if they are, then I would hazard a guess that they are digital because they are in those models. And you can see they're included. You do have a little bag of servo horns and screws for attaching them. Don't see any mounting screws though. For mounting these into the tray. Maybe that's what those little self-tapping screws were for earlier. But that's all the electronics pack, the power pack combo. I'm not sure exactly what they're calling it. But we'll sit all that back in here. Make sure I didn't miss nothing. Move it to the side. Next in the list is the optional landing gear. So like I said, you do have, well, you have some little instructions with it. Actually, this is mapping bay instructions on the back and landing gear assembly instructions on this side. But it basically shows you how your nose wheel, steerable nose wheel assembly goes together and your main gear. Main gear is very simple. It's just a little bent aluminum cut piece, and it's going to attach to the fuselage with two screws. Your wheels are going to attach down here with these included axles, which are actually just machine screws and lock nuts. Yeah, you have a nut to tighten it to the aluminum piece and a lock nut so that you can set the wheel so that they rotate freely. You have your three wheels, you have your two larger main wheels and one smaller nose wheel. And you also have a nose wheel piece here. And one thing I'm not seeing actually, yes, it's in this bag, is your the strut for the nose wheel that's in here with your die cut, a laser cut rather, plywood parts, your nose wheel strut. And this is the hardware for attaching it and setting it up as far as the wheel collars and your linkage for your servo and everything, including a little screw lock connector and the Z-band push rod. And speaking of servo, you do have the servo and an extension, another one of those little safety connectors, and the horn and the mounting screws and everything for attaching the servo. So they do give you a separate servo for that, and I guess you'll use one of those Y leads, unless there's one in here. Yeah, there's actually a Y lead in here as well. So they give you everything to set up your landing gear, which we will set all of this aside and take a look at the next accessory. Let's look at the mapping bay stuff. So this is actually quite a lot of laser cut plywood parts, and I apologize, I've bumped the camera. So this is all of the parts which you will need to assemble. These are all laser cut light ply parts, and you see there's quite a number of them, and I think this is actually for two different style camera bays. And you also get another bag here, which includes the instructions and this little sticky backed foam neoprene type of stuff. And I'm guessing this is to line the inside with, because I do see like a GoPro shaped cutout here, and the session style cutout there. So I guess this is going to line the inside, keep your camera mounted snug and keep it from getting scuffed up and things like that. And these are some instructions for the mapping camera bay, and once again the landing gear instructions are on the back, but it is included with both. So they basically give you a quick kind of exploded diagram of how they go together and how you set it up for different camera styles. So yeah, that'll be pretty interesting when we build that later on and try it out. But for now, I'm gonna sit all of these parts aside, and I will need to put these back in a bag at a later date so that I don't lose any parts. Because like I said, there is quite a few parts there, and you will need something like the NCA or whatever glue to assemble it. And that's another point that I didn't mention earlier. When you are attaching your tail surfaces and all of the little lenses and things like that, there's no glue included, but I would recommend using something similar to like this one, this Bob Smith Industries foam cure. It stays pretty flexible. It really sticks well to EPO and clear plastic. It's actually EPO and EPP foam glue. It's formulated for that, and it gives you a 15-30 minute cure time. But when you glue the little clear accessories, the little clear lenses and things like that, CA tends to fog up clear plastic. This stuff does not fog it up at all. So this is what I will be using, and I recommend it. I've actually had this for quite some time, and it just stays good. And the little cap here is broke, so it doesn't seal airtight anymore, but it doesn't cure in the bottle. It's pretty good. It lasts without going bad, kind of like CA will. So if you're looking for something, that's the glue I recommend. But anyway, getting back to the model, this little threaded thumb screw here is going to be the one that attaches your mapping camera mount into the bay. And so that goes with that set. And the last accessory is the navigation lights. This is the DUSK 3-position lighting system for RFC planes. You can actually see on the front there, they have a picture of the binary. It's what it's intended for. So we'll see what all is included. It comes in a little plastic case. And you can see on the inside of the little paper insert there, there's a little diagram of what goes where and how to lay it out in the airplane. And once again, it's actually intended for the binary. There's little drawings and diagrams there. So as far as what's inside, you get the little control board here, which has your battery input. You plug your main battery in, and there is a little included connector with some tinned leads that plugs in, that you will attach to whatever in your airplane. We'll probably use one of those BEC connectors. I'll put a BEC connector on the other end of this and use one of those taps on the ESCs to feed battery voltage into here. This is for a PWM servo cable, which will plug into there. And then you have your left landing light, your right landing light, your left navigation light, your right navigation light, and a tail light. And you see you have little connectors, little ports around the sides for that. And the bottom is just clean, nothing there. So that will get mounted in the fuselage. And you see these are your different lights. We'll go ahead and pull one out. Just take a look at it. If we can push it out of the foam. And you see they all do have these little paper labels. Like this is your right landing light. This is your right navigation light. Left navigation light. Left landing light, and the one that we've taken out to look at is the tail light, tail navigation light. So you see you have the little matching connectors, obviously, which will plug into the control board. Like, so they only fit one way. So they'll plug into the control board like that. Then there's some really small little flexible silicone coated wires, which will be good when you're mounting them, embedding the wires into the surfaces and things like that. They'll be easy to tuck them into a little slit in the foam. The light itself is kind of neat. You see you have a total of 8 little surface mount LEDs. There's 4 on each side. And there's actually a little tab that will get stuck into the foam. So like on the top of the rudder, for example, we can actually take a look at it. On the top of the fin here, when you go to mount it, you'll actually center that up and kind of insert it into the foam like so. Make sure you kind of keep everything centered. And it'll get mounted into the surface like that. Then you'll kind of cut the little slit and run your wire down into the fuselage and then glue the clear lens over it. And you'll have 4 LEDs on this side and 4 LEDs on this, on the other opposite side. So it'll be visible in both directions from both sides. So that's pretty nice. Pretty neat. I like that little setup. And there's another paper in the bottom that's just another one just like the top insert. Exact same thing with the instructions and things like that. So, finally, what was supposed to be a short, quick video taking a look at the airplane has gone on now for nearly an hour. I'm rather surprised at that myself. So, if you have stuck through the entire video, I thank you for that. Hopefully, I've given you a close enough detailed look at everything to answer any questions you might have. If not, post them in the comments below. Do check out the affiliate links. They will help me fund everything because, like I said, actually we can take a look at the components that I've picked up for the bill. These I bought with my own money. They didn't provide this. This is a T1013 video transmitter from Electrify RC. I bought that from Hobby Wireless. As you can see, the decals they provided with it. That's the video transmitter I'm going to use. It is a little bit more expensive than the part-time style that I normally use. This one is an Electrify RC. It is switchable 1280 and 1258 megahertz. This is the US version. They do have an international version. It has these neat little ceramic heat sinks. And it's switchable between 500 milliwatts and 1 watt output. So we'll be taking a look at this one. I just wanted to try out something a little bit more premium and see how it works, if it's any better than what I'm used to using. And like I said, I also bought another Eagle Tree Vector. It's your standard Vector, you know, the full size one, regular Vector. And both of the Vectors that I have now, I have one in my Sky Hunter and one in the Dart XL, have the version 1, the original GPS. This one has a version 2, which uses GLONASS. So it should be a little bit better GPS than I'm used to having on the Vector. And you have all your standard accessories, the XT60 version, current sensor, little compass mount, post, some decals, and wiring harness for that. So, like I said, if you use the affiliate links, it'll help me recuperate some of the costs for the stuff that I've bought out of pocket. And once again, thank you to Sonicmodell for providing the model and all of these neat accessories to go with it. And one thing that I don't have yet, I'm actually going to have to borrow one from another airplane, is my DragonLink receiver. I'm going to be using the micro-sized V3 receiver so that I can assign some of the extra PWM outputs. I'll run SBUS into the vector, and then I'll have all my PWM outputs on the channel bank to run things like the pan and tilt and the flaps if I choose to do those, and the nav lights and things like that that you won't plug into the flight controller itself. The autopilot vector. So anyway, this has been an hour-long video. I apologize, but I really don't think I could have made it any quicker. Thank you for watching it. Thank you for checking out the links below the video. And of course, big thank you to the Patreon supporters and everybody involved in making this happen. So stay tuned. The next video, I'll have this built and ready to fly, and we'll take a look at everything and hopefully get it in the air soon. So keep an eye out for that.